In our last lesson, we looked at and talked about how entropy is the real driving force, and that is for anything. If something's going to happen spontaneously, we have to have a positive change in the entropy of the universe, and we saw that just in its system alone, it tends towards more disorder. We're going to look at not entropy this time, but enthalpy in this lesson. We're going to look at the intermolecular attractions. We are breaking attractions and forming attractions as we make a solution. Breaking attractions requires energy. Forming attractions releases energy. The pulling apart requiring energy is very intuitive to us, but to have releasing energy when they come together isn't so much. But remember this. If one way you do something, pulling apart, does one thing with the energy, then doing the opposite will do the opposite in terms of energy. If one is endothermic, the other is exothermic. Okay? So requires energy to pull apart, intuitive. Releasing energy is the opposite process, and that is going to give it off. So let's look what's happening on the intermolecular level. On the molecular level. As we look at the solute, we know that if we had pure solute, that the molecules are sitting right next to each other. And let's imagine that this right here is a solid. It doesn't have to be, but in this case, it looks like a solid to me. And in order to get the solvent molecules around those solid molecules, we're going to have to be able to pull them apart. And so that is pulling them apart, and that would be requiring energy for step one. Now, does it do it in this stepwise fashion? No, they don't all say, okay, first let's move apart. Okay, now you guys move apart. But here's our solvent, and it is a liquid. Okay, so we have our liquid. There's no room for those solute molecules in there, so they also must be pulled apart. So that's going to require energy. Once we've pulled them apart, we would be now able to have them join together and form attractions. So we're forming intermolecular attractions, not there, well, maybe there, in between molecules. Okay, so they're coming back together to form that solution. If it requires energy to pull apart, we talked about how it releases energy when it comes together. So let's kind of circle those delta H's so that we don't lose them there. Those are the enthalpies of those steps. So the magnitude of the delta H1 here has to do with how strong are those things attracted to each other. If they're really strongly attracted to each other, it's going to take a lot of energy to pull them apart. How connected are these with each other? If they're connected with a strong intermolecular attraction, it would take a lot of energy to pull them apart. So delta H2 would be big. When they come together, it's going to release energy, and it's going to release energy based upon how strong those are to attract to each other. Now, to form the solution, and there is a delta H of the formation of a solution, which is very measurable. We can measure that with calorimetry quite easily. It is going to be these three combined steps that we see out there. And this is Hess's law in application. Remember, Hess's law says that whether you do something in one step, make a solution, okay, we dump them together and a solution forms, or we do it in a series of steps, there's three steps that we're doing here, the change in enthalpy would be the same. So we can set that equal to each other, and that's an application of Hess's law. So I want you to think about the sign convention of delta H1, 2, and 3. So pause and pick the sign that you would know that delta H1, 2, and 3 would have. Well, I hope that you remember the connection between the sign and requiring versus releasing, requiring being endothermic and releasing being exothermic. With that information, we would know that this would be the right answer. Okay, delta H1 is positive and 2 is positive because they require, they are, we use the word endothermic, and this step releases energy, so it's exothermic, and those are the signs of endothermic and exothermic. Okay, so I've put those in this image here so we see what the sign is. Now, can we say with certainty what delta H of the solution is going to be? No, we cannot say with certainty. It could be positive, It could be negative, but there are some limitations as to this, and this has to do with the matchup, basically. The matchup of the intermolecular attractions between the molecules versus between the molecules in the solute and the solvent by themselves. So let's think about the sign convention here. When would the delta H of the solution, which was this thing right here, when would it be exothermic? I want you to pause and choose an answer. Well, when this is positive and this is positive and this is negative, we know that those are the sign conventions. This represents the solute-solute interactions. This represents the solvent-solvent interactions, and this is the solute-solvent interactions, okay? So which one do we need to be bigger? We need the negative ones to be bigger. So the solvent, where did it go? The solvent-solute, the negative one, has to be greater than the other two. Because the negative one, which is this guy, has to win out, and that's when you would have an exothermic delta H of solution. So some things, when you dump them together, are exothermic. Let's back up one. Opposite is true, and we got to be careful about this. We could have a situation in which it is endothermic. Well, I don't know what I'm doing wrong there. I'm hitting a button here. Okay, endothermic. Let's think about that. When would it be endothermic? When it takes a lot more energy to do these steps than is released, because these are positive, when this forms. Now, if this isn't almost as big as the other two, if the minus is not almost as big as the other two, then we are in trouble. Okay, you will not be able to form a solution because it is too endothermic. But if it could absorb a little bit of extra energy from the surroundings to overcome the fact that it's not getting enough released here to overcome these two steps, then we would, if it can't get enough from the surroundings, we won't form a solution. So the delta H of the solution can be positive. And it can be negative. It can be both. Sometimes when you make a solution, it gets hot, you feel it as heat released, and that would be exothermic. Sometimes it feels cold, and that would be endothermic, but there is a limit. It can't be too much of this. All right, it can't be extremely endothermic. So what is going to make this happen? Okay, we talked about solutions dissolving in each other when like dissolves like, and that takes us back to the chapter on intermolecular forces. If they have similar types of intermolecular forces, then the size of those delta H's will be just right in order to form a solution. So here's benzene. Benzene is nonpolar. Hydrocarbons are always nonpolar. Here's CCl4, a carbon surrounded by four chlorines and no lone pairs on that central atom. So that is a tetrahedral and it is nonpolar. Since they are both nonpolar, they will be soluble in each other. So there's a certain amount of energy it takes to pull molecules of benzene apart from each other, a certain amount of energy it takes to pull the carbon tetrachloride molecules apart from each other, and the energy released as they come together is around the same value because they have similar intermolecular attractions. That is a reminder, in case you forgot, that hydrocarbons are one of our favorite nonpolar entities to pull out when we're doing examples. Ethanol and water are both very polar. They both meet the criteria for hydrogen bonding, okay? So they are not only polar, but they meet the criteria for hydrogen bonding and form this super strong intermolecular force. And so they are both soluble in each other, and you can get it to dissolve into each other to any extent. There's no limitation to the solubility. So things that have similar intermolecular forces are going to have the delta H values on the right magnitude in order to form a solution. The term miscible means that you can dissolve it in all proportions, and that is what we see with ethanol, C2H5OH, that's ethanol, that is drinking alcohol, and water. Okay, they are miscible. You can put a little bit of ethanol in water, or you can put twice as much ethanol as you have water. And they kind of switch places of who's a solvent and who's a solute. That's what the word miscible means, okay? Just so you know. Now, like dissolve like does not help us predict ionic compounds and whether they're soluble in water. Ionic compounds are very polar, right? They're super polar in that they have a cation and they have an anion, absolutely as polar as you can get. Whereas water is just partial, but it's still a very polar molecule, right? We have a partial negative end, a partial positive end. They're both polar, but they're not necessarily soluble in each other. We have to remember our solubility rules in order to know whether or not ionic compounds will dissolve in each other. And this really takes us back to entropy. Is the change in the entropy of the universe greater than zero? And in some cases, for reasons we won't get into, but if you want to have a side conversation, I'd be happy to talk to you. For some reason, this doesn't happen sometimes when you dissolve these ionic compounds into water. Now that guy's looking stressed out there simply because he doesn't want to go back and memorize his solubility rules. And you don't have to either, okay? You don't have to memorize those rules, but I just want to let you know that like dissolves like really applies to molecular compounds. You can predict very well from one molecular compound to another whether the energies are going to work out well in order to form that solution. So that's what's happening on the molecular level with those energies in order for us to understand why some solutions, when you make them, get hot, they're exothermic, and some solutions, when you make them, are cold, endothermic.